The revolution will be broadcast.
Doesn't that sound exciting to you?
Welcome back, Shadow Nation, to the one, the only, Mystifying Oracle Radio. Your ghost man and demon hunter show, Demon Hunter.
The whole world is doomed, and we're all gonna die.
We're all gonna die!
Happy Sunday, everybody!
On that note. Anyway, guys, special thanks to all our homes, all our sponsors, Stitcher, Smart Radio, Spreaker, the world is listening. Are you? Check them out, Spreaker.com, Planet Paranormal, Geeky Antics Network, Serious Geeks, Silly Fun, GeekyAntics.net, Attentive Home Healthcare, AttentiveHHC.com. Good people ready to help the ones you love in Indianapolis and around the world. Give them a call, AttentiveHHC.com. The SYL Project, give some love, share some love. Everybody needs that love. The SYLProject.org. Welcome back to Studio World. Yeah.
Welcome back to Studio, Sean Burris.
You know, the more homes and sponsors we get, I'm going to need a bigger intro.
You're going to need a longer song.
I'm going to need a bigger intro. We're going to need a bigger intro. I watched that like three times this week, man. I thought of you. I did. I forgot to tell you before the show went live. I watched that Jaws, of course, the classic.
Oh, yeah.
And I can do Jaws 2. I don't know if you're in agreement with me. This is an argument thing here. It's okay. I'm possibly opening up a can of worms because you're a huge Jaws fan. I'm a huge Jaws fan. I come out to Connecticut, you, the wife, and I watch Jaws and the making of, and I can
because it's one of the greatest movies of all time.
That's true. That's true. You can say that without, you know, even stuttering on that. That's absolutely true. But can you do, what would you say Jaws 2 and Jaws 1, are they comparable at all? Or are they off the chart? You can't say the two together.
Jaws 1 is in a class by itself.
True, true. And it's hard to make a follow-up show to a classic like that. But would you agree?
Even Stephen King didn't want to do it. Or Stephen King, sorry. Steven Spielberg.
Oh, my God. You said Stephen King.
We were talking Stephen King earlier. What can I say?
You got the new it on the brain, don't you?
Yeah. But even he didn't want to do it. He said, I've already made the iconic shark movie. Why do I want to do another one?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he was absolutely right. Now, mm-hmm, on a scale of a like sea creature, monster, shark movie, Jaws 2 is probably among the top.
Right.
I mean, it's definitely a good movie. And of course, you can't go wrong with the cast. The
almost the same cast.
Yeah. And then, of course, Jaws 3 came out.
Mm-hmm. We're not going to talk about that, right? That was our hurt.
The poster is actually hanging right above in my studio.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Is that the one you need 3D glasses to see? It's not, is it?
The movie was originally 3D.
Yeah, but they used to have posters. Remember that?
Yeah, the posters were in 3D, some of them. No, I have one of the original 2D posters. It is my wife's favorite movie of all time. She can't help but watch it every time it comes on. Right. To her, Jaws 3 is what Jaws is for you and me.
Yeah.
And
well, I remember everybody was saying, because we lived through the 3D craze.
Yeah.
Where, you know, 3D.
When it came back, where they tried to bring it back.
Yeah, when they tried to bring that back. Because I remember a local radio show here, it was Bob and Tom, 97.1 here in Indianapolis. And they were like the jokester hit rock station. And I remember it was a Saturday night, and they would say, they had a thing going with Pizza Hut. And they would say, run to Pizza Hut and get your, it was a cross promotion, and make sure to get your 3D glasses. You remember this? Did you have that in Connecticut?
I had that for when they were doing the, I was in Jersey at the time.
Right.
Remember, I'm a Jersey boy at heart.
Yeah.
And it was Burger King. You had to get your 3D glasses. But it wasn't for Jaws 3.
Okay.
It was for the Channel 11 was doing 3D movies.
Oh.
And you had to go pick up the 3D glasses. And in fact, didn't we have Svengoolie?
We did, yeah.
Svengoolie was on, and he actually was the host of that.
Really?
Yes. And he says to this day, people come up and complain to him about it.
Oh, wow.
I remember the commercials in between. The best 3D was when they were going to commercial, they'd have it like, we'll be right back. Right. You know, you can take off your 3D glasses, and as they'd say that, a mummy would be reaching out to you, and it would look like it was reaching out, or a guy would be shooting pool, and the pool stick would come straight at you. And
it's a pool stick!
Yeah, and I remember that was the best 3D through the whole thing. The rest of the movies were awful.
Yeah.
Because you had to set your TV just right to get the 3D.
I don't know.
The old movies.
I was thinking about that. I was thinking about that the other day, actually, because... You know, all this nostalgia got me thinking of our favorite Stephen King movies. And, of course, it's a very exciting time for Stephen King Nights. Did I say that right? King of Nights? Followers of Stephen King. Anyway, fans of Stephen King, right? You're with
Kingers?
Me. The Kingers. Kingites? Yeah, we'll say the Kingites, even though his publicist won't call me back. But, right, Nate, we hold no personal...
I sent him a free book once because I read a book, or I listened to a book on tape. Yeah. And, I really enjoyed it, and having enjoyed one of his books on tape, and at the end it said how much he enjoyed books on tape. He actually used to have his children. He'd pay them to read books into a tape recorder so that he could listen to them.
Really?
Yep. And since I knew he loved books on tape, and I had picked up this particular book and listened to it on tape, I liked it. I sent it to him, and it got sent back to me unread, having gone through his office, and that said, Mr. King does not accept any literature gifts or literature gifts or proposals for stories through the mail. And I was like, I was sending him a gift.
And Whatever.
That was back when I was a Kingite myself.
So. Steven, you're out of touch with the little people, brother. You need to come on the show and save yourself.
Standing down at the bottom of your driveway and handing out chocolate bars on Halloween is not enough, Steven.
That's right. Make it right. Come on the G&D show.
That's right.
We need those t-shirts. Anyway, Stephen King's it, man. I put that...
Yes, I know. I'm a little disappointed to hear that they're remaking it.
Oh, man. No. No.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I was watching it last night.
I love the original.
Made for TV... You know, it's a classic. I'm not going to take that away from it. I love it. The kids were amazing in it. The old actors.
John Boy.
What's in that? Jack Tripper. Remember that?
Yes.
Three's Company. He was in it. And it was a great show. But I'm
Judge
gonna...
Stone, you know.
Yeah. Well, from the set, let me just read you this. Stephen King's It remake, September 2017. God, we gotta wait away. Anyway, after announcing a remake back in 2008, Nathan, and a huge amount of delays later, they are currently halfway through filming part one, which will be released in mid-September of 2017. So they're gonna attempt this two-part deal.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. You're a fan of The Shining, correct?
Oh, I love The Shining.
And you remember when Stephen King remade The Shining almost word for word to his book?
Yeah.
And it made for TV.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody turned around and said, eh.
Wasn't that a sci-fi thing? Oh, yeah. It's not even... You got to get it on the eBay dime store shelf or whatever.
Because Stephen King wants his book, the movies to be made word for word the way his books were. And you can't do that because the imagery is... You can't recreate that imagery from the book.
Yeah.
So it's... I don't know. Go ahead, finish your story.
Director Andrew Muschietti from Mama. You might remember that movie. That's pretty good. The little girl is raised by the spirit in the wood thing. Anyway, he has been posting some teaser photos on his Instagram this week, and it looks like they're very faithful to the book and including a lot of references, not including the 90s miniseries, including 29 Neil Bolt Street, where they first see it, the Leaper chase scene and the Easter egg hunt scene. So, I guess... Bill Skarsgård is playing Pennywise, And a lot of people have, they've been showing, they came out last week, of course, with the first images of the new Pennywise. Have you seen these?
I have seen one photo on Facebook. That was it.
Kind of wearing an outfit like a jester would back in the King's Court days type thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, you know, it looks spooky and everything. I mean, how much spookier can you make it? It's a clown.
It's a clown. They're as evil as they come.
Yeah, they're as evil as they come. Anyway, the cast of Stephen King loved him so much they selected him for the role of Pennywise. And first, what movies else has he been in? Bill Skarsgård. I should know this.
You should. I don't.
I don't know. Anyway, you remember the Young Losers Club are currently filming the first time, and the majority of them are unknowns and have all been recast since the new director came aboard, except Stranger Things actor, was from our last show. We got up close and personal with Stranger Things with David Harbour from Stranger Things.
Uh-huh, that's correct. That's right. Correct.
Finn Wolfhard. You remember the kid you said that... he was the leader of the gang, the one that is a little different?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, apparently he's going to be playing one of the leader of the gang. Was it Bill? Was the kid's name Bill? I forget. Anyway, actor
got me beat.
Finn Wolfhard, guys, from Stranger Things. He's going to be the kid, and apparently they're showing all these missing wanted posters for this kid. So apparently he gets stalled, so we're going to call him like a milk carton kid. And it says, like Stranger Things, this will also be set in the 1980s instead of the 50s for the flashbacks.
No, come on.
Yeah, I know that's gonna take something off. But still, the 80s, okay, that's going to be flashback for us. And then when we're older, it'll be flashback to the 2010s, the 2000s. So they're saying there's going to be a very similar tone between Stephen King's new It remake and Stranger Things on Netflix. Which, Nathan, if that's it, Stranger Things proved to the world, Stranger Things on Netflix, that there is a huge, huge outcry for our age group nostalgic television programs.
Yeah, I will admit that. I mean, hey, you know, you and I both know that television is based on the advertisers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were on TV. We had our ratings were right where they wanted them. Mm-hmm. But our statistics showed that we had the youngest age group that had ever watched an A&E television show.
Yeah.
And they said, oh, well, the advertisers don't like it. We're canceling you. And because they weren't selling stuff to 15 and to 17 year olds. They were selling stuff to 35 year olds to 50 year olds.
Yeah.
So we the same kind of thing. This is going out there. It's focusing on the 80s.
Yeah.
You and I grew up in the 80s. We're in our 40s now. We're the people with the money.
Yeah.
Let's face it, the millennials don't have any. They're still living in their parents' basement. So it's, you know, it's our age group they're focusing on, because that's the thing that these people who own these companies have to remember.
Yeah.
If we stop spending the money, they're out of business.
Yeah. Anyway, hey, so. If anybody's in chat, guys, if nobody's in there, which you're probably not because nobody seems to be signing the chat here lately, but tell us what you're drinking tonight. Of course, G&D Show is a beer drinking show, and we condone the drinking of beers from your safety of your home or somewhere where you're not driving. So let us know if you're drinking any smooth beer
yes,
tonight.
Do not drink if you're listening to us in your car.
I break
that would be bad.
I broke out the old Sam Adams Oktoberfest today, Nathan.
Did you? I'm still drinking Yingling. I'm giving it about two more weeks till I start going to my Oktoberfest. And I saw leaves falling, though, Sean.
You did.
Leaves were falling today.
They're not crisp,
I woke up,
though.
I went downstairs, yellow leaves falling down from the trees. Yesterday, driving up I went up to the fair yesterday just to check it out, and leaves falling from the trees, turning orange and yellow. So,
hey, let's see what they were
saying. It's coming.
Yeah, I can't wait for that, man. I couldn't wait for the beer because I was at the store already getting the pumpkin out. But let's see.
Oh, by the way, Sean, you were asking earlier about Bill Skarsgård's acting history. He is most known at this time for the Divergent series.
Okay.
Emperor.
Right.
A Stone Appears, Battle Creek, Simple Simon, Hemlock Grove,
mm-hmm.
and Simon In the Oaks or something like that, and a list of other movies. But basically, what really brought him up to the top here was the Divergent series. So
Hemlock Grove, huh? It seems like they're starting to pull from the old Netflix casting calls, man. Maybe we should focus on Netflix from now on.
Maybe we should focus it on Netflix.
That's what I'm talking about.
The G&D show on Netflix.
That's what I'm talking about. Forget these major studios. Netflix is major now. They're producing their own stuff. Anyway, talking about it, let's run through this real quick. See if the rest of the world agrees with you, Nathan. You harbinger of doom with the It remake. Anyway, First Lady Gru says, looks good even though the Tim Curry original is near perfect. It will be cool to see a version with better special effects, though.
Yeah. I want to see him float. We all float down here.
Yeah, Georgie. Sini says the original was terrifying as a child. Are they splitting it into two parts for the remake? Question. It doesn't really need to be two parts. I agree, Sini.
It could just be one four-hour-long movie.
Yeah. Well, I mean, come on, man. Make it a Titanic-type length movie. Let's do it.
Think of the length of the book, and if he's doing it word for word, it's going to be a long movie.
Well, let's check this out, Sowie. This isn't a Star Wars saga, okay? This is a great, scary movie about some kids that grew up or whatever, and I understand the need for one and two or whatever. I'm kind of curious how they're going to leave it off, though, because it's not like it's two different stories. And with the television miniseries, Nate, it's a lot different waiting 7 days for the next running of your show.
Yeah, but nowadays when they do a television miniseries, they tend to do them like on Sunday and Monday night.
Yeah.
They don't make you wait the week anymore.
Wasn't it the week when we were kids, though?
It was the week when we were kids. But now when they do them, it's like it airs Sunday night, or nobody airs something new Sunday night anymore because they don't want to compete with Walking Dead. But
got that locked down.
And us. They don't want to compete with us.
No,
either.
Who would?
They tend to do it Sunday and Monday nights now, or they'll do it Sunday and Tuesday night. Yeah. But they don't do it. They don't do it on a week apart anymore.
Yeah. Anyway, Terminus says the book is epic enough to be split into two, if you ask me. And then Terrible Mural says the book is over 100 pages. Oh no, over 1,000 pages. So two parts makes sense, like you were just saying, Nate. As you could never get everything into one film. The 90s version was a four-hour TV event cut down for the DVD. And even then, the writer said it was too difficult.
Well, you have kids, Sean.
So there we go.
You took them to see the Harry Potter movies, right?
No. We never went to the movie to see them. We seen them at home, though.
Oh, okay. So you did they read the books?
No, they never got in. I wish they had them because Harry Potter was pretty good.
It was an interesting storyline, and if you looked at the original book, it was a short book.
Right.
And each book got longer and longer and longer until it got up to like the sixth and seventh book, and when they made the movies, people were complaining that they were cutting too much out to make the movies. And that's why when it got to the eighth movie, they split it in two.
Right.
Because there was so much that they had to split it in two to get everything in. Well, then, of course, that gave every tween movie out there the same idea, not for the same reason that they had for the Harry Potter movies, but because now they could sell two movies. So now every movie that does a series does it Section 1, Section 2, Section 3A, Section 3B.
I don't know. I'm excited for it, though. I'm excited. So
you should be, Sean. You should be.
Well, anything Stephen King, man. It takes me back. So anyway.
You've had time to look it up this week since you've been sitting at home with an ear infection.
Last 3 days, man, I was off work. That's crazy. Vertigo. Have you guys ever heard of vertigo out there?
Oh, yeah. I had vertigo.
Yeah. It is some serious stuff. I mean, it's like wake up, grab the bed, because holy cow, you're on a roller coaster. And I thought I was dying for a second, but I woke up and I came down the stairs to get Sis ready to go to the bus stop, man. And I couldn't even walk down the stairs. She's like looking at me going, oh, my God, a little early for drinking, isn't it, Dad? But I was going, yeah, man, I couldn't stay on the stairs.
Never too early for drinking, little girl.
And I thought I thought the next day I would be better. I thought it would just wear off. And I thought, well, maybe blood pressure's up or my sugar was lower. I didn't eat enough or something. But no, I went to the doctor and they looked at my ear and said, oh, my God. So, you know, it's a weird how just a little bitty thing like fluid in the ear and some infection can throw your whole thing out of whack.
And they probably gave you some antibiotics.
They did. They did.
And you ever wonder, Sean, think about this. Antibiotics. What did they do for something like that before they had the antibiotics?
They just suffered through it.
Well, there were several different things they would do for it, one of which I actually grew up using, even though antibiotics were already out. I'm not that old.
You did investigate this matter. I like it.
And the big one when I was a kid was warm tea tree oil.
Okay.
Was they would put drops of warm tea tree oil in your ear, which would relax the ear, get the fluid loosened up and moving, and would end the infection quicker. A popular treatment, even today, but more so back then, was ear candling.
Oh, yeah. I have heard of that, yeah.
Now, they are recommending that you do not, the FDA and other groups recommend that you do not use ear candling. It is a hollow candle placed over the ear, lit so that it creates a warmth in the ear and sucks the impurities up through the ear canal into the candle. However, I have experimented with ear candling before, Sean, and set it in an empty, clean container, lit the candle, and it looked as black inside as it would as if you had done it in somebody's ear. So obviously, it's not necessarily the goop in your ear being sucked out. And it can cause ruptures in the ear and actually help spread the ear infection.
Really?
Other treatments include home remedies such as garlic drops.
Okay. Not just good against vampires, also ear infections.
No, also good against ear infections. The big one my mom used to use for me, I'm sure she did for you, your mom, not my mom.
Right.
Heating pads and hot water bottles.
Yes, heating pad, absolutely.
I mean, the greatest invention of all time, the heating pad, because I remember my mother actually making hot water bottles for me when I was a kid, boiling water, putting it in a glass bottle, wrapping it in towels, and putting it under my pillow.
Yeah, I remember the heating pad, yeah.
And that towel kind of rolls off and you lean up against that hot bottle. Boy, did that hurt.
wake up with you scalded. My child scalded, but his ear feels better.
Yes. Many people say mango leaf juice.
Okay, mango.
Onion juice. Salt being considered probably the number one home remedy for any infection.
Sounds like hippie remedies to me. Don't trust
them. And I don't get the one that says basil.
Okay.
Here's one that you'd like, Sean. Breastfeeding.
Oh, that always sounds.
Oh, sorry, Sean. It says only for infants. For infants.
Well.
It helps increase blood flow and fills the child with the. I just lost it. That was the best one. How did I lose that?
You can't lose it. It fills the child. My God, man.
It also helps the child build up their immune system against the ear infection by helping build up the immunity that the mother already has. But yeah, I mean,
see that.
Lots of things. And let's not forget, let's go farther back, Sean, leeching.
Right. Leeching. Oh, yeah. Well, everybody loves that.
And did you know they're using leeching more and more today?
No.
Especially for cosmetic surgery. Leeching back then, you had an ear infection. They figured you had something evil inside of you, some bad blood, and the leech would draw it out. Now, the leeches are used on people's faces and other parts of their body when having cosmetic surgery to draw blood to the surface of the skin to increase healing. So, little topics you get there, Sean. What do you think?
Oh, I like that. It's interesting to see what's cooking around in my ear. But now I'm 3 days into antibiotic sessions or whatever cycle.
So you don't need leeches now.
No, I'm not going to put a leech down my ear. Thank you, though, brother, for looking out for me. But you know what, Nathan? We almost forgot. Without further ado, sir, I think we should probably do this, right?
I think we should.
Let's do it. Tonight's guest is the Conjuring Arts Research Center Executive Director and author of the New York Times bestselling book, The Secret Life of Houdini. He is a lifelong student of sleight of hand, magic, and its history. His research into the roots of magic and the conjuring arts make him one of the most sought after in the realm of magic. He worked closely with many magicians, including David Blaine, to produce stage and television shows based on historic magic techniques. Yes, Shadow Nation, tonight we're joined by author of the New York Times best-selling book, The Secret Life of Houdini, Mr. William Kalush. Right here, tonight, on your Mystifying Home. Wait, Mystifying Oracle of Radio. The Ghost Man and Demon Hunter Show. Bill Kalush, Nathan. Houdini. What else do you
need? We get to call him Bill, right?
Well, I'm going to call him Bill. His publicist said to call him Bill, so I'm excited about that. I think I'm going to have to call him Bill.
There
just one way to do it. Anyway, hey guys, say hi to all our people in chat. We can't see y'all. I can see Paul. Mr. Paul Oxenham is in there. Paul, what's up, buddy? He says, Houdini and breast. Nice. I agree, Paul. I agree. Breast, hands down. But I am a Houdini fan. Absolutely. So that's going to be a good one tonight, Nate. We've had magicians on here in the past. Of course, most notably, Nathan. Master magician, Mr. Lance Burton. Remember that one?
Indeed. I have an autograph poster of him or a picture of him hanging right here.
Indeed, you do. Did you get it hanged up?
It's still in the plastic wrapper, but okay. It's hanging up on the wall. I haven't got it framed yet.
I see. Well, at least you did get that. So, yeah, Lance, a good friend of ours. We love him so much. I remember I was outside the studio one day. I had the wife in the car, and she said, hey, we got some mail, and she was going through it, and she went through this, and she opened it up, and it was Lance Burton saying, hey, thanks, guys, for the interview and being on the show. And she goes, who else can say that Lance Burton sends them stuff in the mail saying thank you? You know, I said, well, see, that's the glorious life of being married to radio people. Yeah, it's glorious. Yeah, I'm still trying to sell that anyway. But she seems to like it. So what else is going on?
Sell it. You're trying to sell your picture?
Yes. No, I'm not trying to sell my pictures. You weren't following the story. I'm trying to tell my wife that she's so lucky to be married to a radio host.
Oh.
Anyway. Hey, did you see this?
I tell my wife that all the time.
Did you see the story about the robotic sex dolls one step closer to replacing humans forever?
I did see that story, Sean. I did. And all I could think was... probably just like every other woman out there, going to be out of my price range.
No, but hopefully they got a layaway plan, because I could do that. I could do
layaway. Ooh.
Anyway, guys, HuffPost, real quick, just says we have to come to terms with each other and say, okay, that's for you. This is for me. All right. Anyway, let's go ahead and read this story real quick, Nate. Okay.
Please
it's
do.
A big challenge turning static sex dolls into interactive love robots. But scientists think they're getting over that hump. Yeah, Matt McCullen has been creating realistic-looking human dolls for sex since 1997. He tells 60 Second Docs that the technology needed to make raunchier robots is getting better all the time. People spend about $5,000 to $10,000 for lifelike dolls, but McMullen believes the real value is making the sex doll experience as real as possible. Of course, McMullen. Of course. And then they show a picture of her doll's head on a piece of wood. That doesn't look too erotic to me.
I don't want to know what you do when you're alone with Alien Bob.
Stinky, stinky 2x4. Anyway, I'm moving into the future. I'm going to make the world's finest love robot, he said. One day, two people who are... We got to interview this guy. Anyway, one day, two people who are on two different sides of the earth could engage sexually through their dolls or their... or they're in a virtual environment together. I think those kind of things are going to become very commonplace, guys. There you go.
That's very interesting, Sean, and spooky in general.
So for some people, this is what makes them really what they really want, and it makes them happy, and I don't think anyone should judge them for that, Nathan. That's what it says. Okay, thanks, guys.
Oh, come on. They can judge you for wearing a Trump t-shirt, but they can't judge you for having a sex robot?
Possibly. You never know. You never know. That's... Trump and sex robots. There you go.
Switch yeah. That's going to be... that. Nobody ever quotes us. That will be in the news tomorrow.
That will be. Watch.
Trump endorses sex robots. Hey, Sean, quick feel-good story.
Make me feel good.
Quick feel-good story. Woman's funeral had no attendees, so 30 strangers showed up.
That's beautiful, man.
This comes from Orangetown, New York. About 30 people have paid their respects to a woman they never met after responding to a call for attendees for a suburban New York funeral at which no one was expected to show up. The Journal News reported that strangers, several served as pallbearers,
yeah,
and also helped to bury her during the service Wednesday at a ceremony in Orangetown.
That's beautiful.
Stein, yeah. I guess her name was Francine Stein, died at age 83. Have a drink, folks. If you didn't know, this is the G&D drinking game. When I make a mistake, you take a drink. don't drive and listen to the G&D show. At least not the news if you're going to drink. The rabbi
and the priest walk into a bar.
Yes. The service says there were no I'm sorry.
Just make up the word.
Yeah, I'll just make something up. He didn't know the woman, so there was no eulogy,
okay,
because he didn't know anything about her. He learned at the ceremony that Stein was a musician and had taught at the Juilliard School. The call for... I can't believe a Juilliard instructor had nobody show up.
I know, right?
A call for volunteers came on Facebook from the rabbi's daughter.
Okay, yeah.
One attendee said attending the service was a simple act of human decency.
That's right.
So it kind of reminds me of that old story about somebody who walks into a funeral and nobody's there and he signs the guest book.
Right.
And he goes home afterwards and 30 days later he gets a letter in the mail that says that the person who had died had been a millionaire and said to split the money between everybody who showed up at his funeral. And he was the only one who showed up.
I never heard that one.
That it's an old like legend. Whether it actually ever happened or not, who knows? But it's we should do a show about that, about old stories like that people tell, whether or not they're true or not. The one about Donald Trump being broken down along the side of the road, and somebody pulled over.
He paid off their mortgage.
Change his tire.
Yeah,
Went home, and Donald Trump paid the guy's mortgage.
Right. You know? Right. That's not a true story.
Whether it's true or not, who knows? But the story has gone on for years from one billionaire to another, so who knows?
Anyway, Nate, we got to take a break, brother.
That sounds good to me, sir.
Anyway, guys, just to remind you, since we just did this, in case you got short memories, tonight's guest, he's the Conjuring Arts Research Center Executive Director. He's also a very well-known magician and a student of sleight of hand. The best there is, guys. Author of Houdini, The Secret Life of Mr. Bill Kalush. William Kalush stops by studio tonight. So get ready to that. Get ready to that. I'm talking so fast, I forget what I said. What did I say?
Something about Houdini.
Anyway, guys, each week on this show, we play an independent band. We support, we know the little man. We love him on this show, right, Nate?
We do.
Tonight's band is Anquitia. It's my turn. Name of the band.
Have a drink.
First word, guys, to being successful in the music industry, make sure you have a name of your band that can be pronounced somewhat.
Yeah.
Anquitia. That's the name of it, guys. Name of the song, Like Leaves. Nathan?
Sean?
Shadow Nation. We'll be right back with Bill Kalush. We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Dan Aykroyd, also known as Dr. Ray Stantz, Ghostbuster, and you are listening to Ghostman and Demon Hunter, the Ghostman and Demon Hunter show.
Hey, welcome back, Shadow Nation, to the one and only Mystifying Oracle Radio, your Ghostman and Demon Hunter show. Tonight's guest, he is the Conjuring Arts Research Center Executive Director and author of the New York Times best-selling book, The Secret Life of Houdini. He is a lifelong student of sleight of hand magic and its history. His research into the magic arts and the conjuring arts make him one of the most sought after in the realm of magic. He works closely with many magicians, including David Blaine, to produce stage and television shows based on historic magic techniques. Shadow Nation, please help us welcome tonight to studio Mr. William Kalush. Bill, what's going on, buddy?
Well, I'm excited to be with you tonight and talk a little bit about Houdini or anything you'd like to talk about.
The magic man.
We were talking earlier about ear infections. Do you want to get into that with us, Bill, or should we just...
Well, yeah, we could go back into that. I actually have a problem with one of my ears. We could try to fix that. I'm not sure the people in Manila will like that, but otherwise.
Thrill in Manila. Anyway, Bill, thanks for coming on, brother. And, you know, you've done so much. And I want to be a magician since I was a small, young lad. I've always tried to read the books, and I've done the, and the best I can do is some coin tricks right now. But you, sir, are a master of hand manipulation. You've done it all. I've seen the videos. You've worked side by side with some of the world's greatest magicians. We had Lance Burton on a couple months back. We have the utmost respect. But when it comes to Houdini, you, sir, have this book, The Secret Life of Houdini, that you came out with, and I seen that right away. I started reading, and I said, I got to have this guy, because you dove into his life, man. How did it start for you, your love of magic?
Well, my father was a Marine in World War II and fought on the Battle of Guadalcanal and was horrifically wounded. And as he was recovering, somebody came along and taught him a little magic. So fast forward about 30 years later, I'm a little kid, and he was still doing magic, and he showed me some. And the bug bit early, as it often does, and I've just never grown out of it. And I had a teacher in, I think I was something like eighth grade, and I was already interested in magic, but he held up a book by Milburn Christopher about Houdini and said, every student should read this book. And I don't think any of the rest of them read it, but I read it, and it just enthralled me that you could. It's not just about tricks at that point. It's about a life of magic. And from then on, I was interested in Houdini, and then I kind of, you know, the magicians is a strange love-hate relationship with Houdini, so I was sort of taught not to love Houdini in a strange way. And then when I got older and started doing my own research, I realized, hold it, they're wrong. This guy really was absolutely incredible and important.
Right.
So that got me started working on the book.
Bill, what was it about the love and hate you brought up? Because I would think magicians around the world would have just been Houdini's number one, but why the love-hate?
I know. You'd think that, right? And that's what everybody who's not an insider in magic would assume, and they should be right. But primarily out of jealousy, magicians since the time of Houdini, since the 20s, maybe even before, started knocking him, saying, oh, he's not really a magician, he's just doing escapes, he's a stuntman. Some of them really were just trying to say, well, his card technique isn't as good as mine, so he can't really be a great magician. But they're actually dishonest, and it was untrue, and they really hurt his reputation among magicians for a long time by just basically character assassination. And, you know, I drank that same Kool-Aid. I was told when I was young, well, he wasn't really a great magician, just an entertainer and a showman. And only when I started doing my own research did I realize how far off they were. And, I mean, this is a guy that when he did a show, not every single time, but in many occasions, after he had succeeded in his escape, the audience didn't just give him a standing ovation. They rushed the stage, they picked him up, put him on their shoulders, paraded him around the theater, out the door, down the street, all the way to the rooming house he was staying in. And then many nights they'd stand out and make noise in the streets until he'd lean out of the window and address them. And then they'd wander home. I mean, you know, benevolent, you know, riots almost, right?
Nice.
And I don't know of any other magicians ever that was the end of their show, right? So they can't really throw legitimate stones at Houdini.
Let's face it, they couldn't lift Penn from Penn and Teller up on their
stones. Well, maybe they can now.
Yeah, he has dropped a lot of weight. He's
the miraculous weight loss. Yes.
It was funny. Yeah, he is. I was watching him on a special just last night. Yeah, Sean and I are both magic addicts, and I was watching it. He has a new TV show. I was watching him last night, and I was just, he's got a show, I guess, called Fooled You or something like Fool Me. And if you can pull one over on Penn and Teller, you'll get to be in their show. So, Sean, we need to put together an act.
Yeah, we should.
Two,
we should try.
Two, just as an aside, two of the people who work at Conjuring Arts, you know, our little nonprofit in New York, the library, mm-hmm. Two of our
good people
people have actually been on the show and succeeded.
Oh, wow.
Nice.
So David Roth and Maddie Gilbert have both fooled them. And Penn and Teller are great guys. I know Teller better, but they're both great guys.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. I was watching an old movie, not a really old movie, but The Fantastics, and Teller was one of the actors in it. And I'm watching the whole thing, and for the whole first half of the movie, he doesn't say anything. And I'm sitting there going, I know this character speaks. Did they make it a non-speaking role for Teller? And then all of a sudden, he has this soliloquy in the middle of it, and I'm like, that's what Teller sounds like?
Yeah.
Teller's great.
Well, you know what? I tell you what. Bill, since I was a kid, and I'm going to tell you real quick about my love of magic, and you'll appreciate this because I know all magicians love to sit down and swap how you guys got into this stuff, because magicians have the best stories about being on the road than anybody else, man, and how you guys got into this. That's what drew me to you, I think. It's a crazy bunch of guys. It's like a gypsies, guys and gals. So the old days, back in the 20s, and even before that, how they would go town to town, and especially the old spook shows is what captured me. Of course, Blackstone and Keller, and of course, Keller didn't do spook shows that I know of, but Thurston, all these amazing...
He sort of did.
Did, you know, he really?
They did a spirit cabinet because of the Davenport brothers.
Yeah.
You know, it sort of starts... That spook show thing sort of... Well, if you really want the history of it, I'm sorry to interrupt your story.
No, that's okay, because I got those posters of him downstairs, the amazing Keller holding the... having the spook show cabinet, yeah.
Right. But before, the beginning of... The first magician that I'm aware of that had his own theater. So this is not a touring guy, but this is a guy who actually built a semi-permanent theater in a fixed location and did magic spook shows was a man named Etienne Gaspar Robertson. He was a Belgian who, just after the French Revolution in Paris, had a kind of a Capuchin monastery / convent that had been abandoned.
Oh.
And he rented it out and did the most insane spook shows maybe that have ever been done, and just terrified the daylights out of people. But that could be a whole conversation in and of itself. But spook shows are really, really fascinating, by the way. I share your love and interest in those.
Well, I love them, man. And you know, Nathan and I, we got into the paranormal with the radio show, and we found out people had hauntings, they claimed, and they had alien stuff. So we went around and we investigated all that. My love of magic has always been thrown in with that. I grew up in a house where weird stuff happened, and I think the contrast between, like, Keller and Houdini, and then you had these guys, the Davenport brothers and the Fox sisters, that tried to bring that in, and they hated magicians. Those people did, because Keller and Houdini's, they tried to show these the masses that these guys are fooling you. This is craziness. They're ripping you off. And I seen these things do happen. Paranormal stuff like that. Whether you believe or not, I've had things happen. Grew up in a house. Family did. I know things happen. I'm not saying they're supernatural devils from hell. I'm just saying things happen. And it's not, well, it is magic to me, I guess, because I can't explain it, but I was always drawn to, I always thought the magicians knew the answer. When I was a kid, I always thought, well, they knew. they know what's going on. And if it's right. a magic trick, that's what happened. I used to go to this little card shop down the way, and they would always have the posters of Keller and Thurston and Houdini with the black eyes and the gaze coming out over the crowd. And I was just, mm-hmm. I was hypnotized by it. What, first off, do you believe in the paranormal at all? Being a magician?
Absolutely.
You do? Okay.
Of course
great.
I do.
Okay. Awesome.
There's no possibility that our level of science today can explain everything that's around us.
Right.
We can sometimes come up with a plausible explanation that can't truly be tested, mm-hmm. and we can sometimes, as magicians, duplicate these things. But do we know if it's the same exact thing? No. See, I believe in having your eyes open and being rational, but I also am not a cynical skeptic.
Right.
You know, being skeptical is one thing, but to have already made up your mind that there's no such thing means you're not really a seeker. Right?
I love you, Bill. Big difference.
Well, and this is precisely how Houdini looked at it. Houdini came from it wasn't a religious family, but his father was a rabbi, right? And he told him, now, I'm not Jewish, so I don't really understand the way Jewish heaven is supposed to work, but as a Christian, I know that in that belief, you believe that there's a higher realm, a heaven where the departed could potentially be looking down, right? So Houdini's father told him, kind of a Christian tenet, even though they're not Christians, that if I can help you from above, I will.
Yeah.
And Houdini took that very seriously. I mean, when his father died, if I'm not mistaken, that was 1892, he started seeking seance and mediums, and Grigorovich was one person he saw through his death. I don't think Houdini ever could fully explain everything he saw Grigorovich do.
Right.
And he had an open mind to the idea that it could be true. Even if I see a lot of tricks as I go looking, it could be true. And when he and his wife were struggling as magicians, they turned to doing seances for a living. And they were out in Kansas in the Western Territories, and they did question and answer. They did a number of seance-type things for entertainment purposes, and according to Houdini, they had so many dead-on hits that they themselves couldn't explain that it freaked them out, and they dropped it. They stopped doing it to their own economic detriment. They didn't have an alternative. They didn't drop it because they had a better way to make money. They just couldn't do it. They didn't want to do that anymore. Right. And it's strange because I've read lots of stories of other acts that do fake mind reading, you know, second sight acts that have had strange experiences where information is being collected by the receiver that's not actually having been sent by the sender through their trick method, right? Mm-hmm. So it's very curious, and Houdini did claim to have that experience.
And you and I were talking about this before the show, Bill, that I've always been that guy out there saying Houdini wasn't really a skeptic as much as he was a believer who wanted proof.
I believe that completely. In fact, I would say the skeptics that I know, I do not believe a single one has made a pact with anybody. So upon the first one to depart, try to contact the remaining party.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you know it can't be done, if you think you know it can't be done, you don't need to make a pact. It's just, what's the point?
Right.
Houdini had pacts with all kinds of people.
You're right.
And there were people turning up for years later. And he had pacts with his brother, William, who, when he passed, Houdini sat in his attic for several days waiting for some sign. I mean, this is not the sign of somebody who's a cynical non-believer. This is somebody who's really faithfully looking for the possibility or any sort of message or proof that the life continues after death.
Right.
Now, what about the rumors that during Houdini's world travels, he was acting as a spy?
Well, of course, we started those rumors in a way, although in 18, I think, there were people already talking about this, but they had it wrong. We have a letter in our collection where somebody is accusing Houdini of being a spy, but the implication is that he was a spy for Germany. They were trying to ruin his reputation.
Oh.
So here's what we found, based on starting off with that letter. A competitor, Theo Mauritius, was the one that was spreading the rumor that Houdini was a spy. And I thought, that's so far-fetched and so crazy, but it makes such perfect sense. So I wonder if there could be something there. So we just started looking into everything. We just started turning stones and just had our eyes open. And the first thing we found was that there was a strange parallel. No smoking gun, no direct evidence, but a strange parallel with the U.S. intelligence system. Now, you have to think, this is not NSA, CIA, alphabet soup agencies like we have today.
Right.
They didn't have that kind of intelligence. They had a few people, and maybe they had some citizens that would report back if asked to. There wasn't an enormous intelligence apparatus. A lot of it was run through embassies. If you wanted to know what was going on in a certain city, you had your diplomats. I suspect it still works this way as the basis of getting information in a certain city that could be sent back, right?
Yeah.
So we start digging, and we find out that the chief of the Secret Service, John Wilkie, who'd been a newspaper reporter, was a magician. And he says in the newspapers, "I use magicians as Secret Service agents." Now, he was the first chief of the Secret Service to actually start doing intelligence work other than looking for counterfeiters. And I'm no expert on the history of the Secret Service, but they were trying to use agents and intelligence during the Spanish-American War.
Right.
So Wilkie's a magician. He says he's using magicians. Houdini's timeline in the U.S. lines up with that very well. Houdini says on several occasions to newspapers, "I've been working with the Secret Service." Okay. Other than you could just dismiss all this, and I would be fine with that as, yeah, Wilkie had some magicians maybe, but that doesn't mean it's Houdini. Okay, I can accept that. And Houdini could have just said that, and that's within Houdini's character to say, yeah, I work with the Secret Service, okay, and maybe it wasn't true. Or maybe it was, and maybe it was kind of informal. But leaving that aside, and some other characters that are play a part, but it's, again, it's circumstantial. It is not direct evidence. Houdini then gets on a ship, and he goes to the U.K., and in the U.K. he lands, and he meets a fellow named Melville.
Yeah.
He's the superintendent of Special Branch of Scotland Yard, which is a really early counterintelligence branch of Scotland Yard that would become, and forgive me if it's MI5 or MI6, I probably will confuse and conflate those two,
yeah.
But within a few years of meeting Houdini, which is in 1900, Melville starts MI5.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that they met. We know that as soon as he met Houdini, he endorsed him, and he was a famous guy in England, and that endorsement was important. And we also know that Houdini, as he traveled to adversarial locations in Europe, primarily Germany and Russia, he sent letters back to Melville. We don't have the letters. We have notations out of Melville's professional diary, and he made notes like, I'll give you one off the top of my head, it's a paraphrase. He said, letter in from HH, straight to the War Department with it.
Mm.
So what Houdini's doing, I do not believe he's paid by Melville to do this. I believe if at the most it was a quid pro quo for the endorsement,
right.
And or he's just doing it because Houdini sees England as a great ally of the U.S. And it was probably something to the effect of, hey, Houdini, if you're in Berlin, you know, the Kaiser has a military parade in September. If you see anything interesting, let us know. And I suspect in 1908, which is the last we know of Houdini sending information back, I suspect that's when Houdini first saw a heavier-than-air aircraft, an airplane.
Yeah.
And that was the letter that, if I'm not mistaken, I haven't reviewed this in a few years, but I think that was the letter where Melville said straight to the War Office with it.
So there's a very...
And Houdini's interest in aircraft and first to fly in Australia starts at that point in 1908.
So Hollywood took some liberties, but maybe not that much. Because, like you said, that would make sense, Bill. Because he was, internationally acclaimed. He was invited everywhere.
And I've heard from other... And this is consistent with how these things worked then and even do now. I've heard from old-timers and even some modern people where some branch of intelligence will say, they're not swearing them in as agents. They're just saying, if you're in this circumstance and you hear anything, tell us what you hear.
Right.
And I think that's what Houdini did for them. And I think he did it for a few years, and he probably had a ball. Look, he could go in and talk to prisoners in jail, and he could carry equipment into Russia. And, he had all kinds of access that no intelligence department had anything like in those days. There's some other fishy things, like changing an important aspect of his U.S. passport. Even though his passport had just been issued a few months earlier, when he was leaving the U.K. to go into Germany, they changed it from a naturalized citizen, he had a passport that said he was a naturalized citizen, which he was, mm-hmm. to a natural-born citizen. So if anybody looked at his passport after the fall of 1900, which had been revised and reissued in London, it would say that Houdini had been born in the United States. A story that he knew was false, but that he stuck to for the rest of his life, for 26 more years, okay? Absolutely, unequivocally, he knew it was false. And after that point, he every opportunity he had, he said, I was born in Appleton, Wisconsin, which he knew was totally untrue.
Yeah.
So he knew it was a lie, but he went with it anyway. Did he have any plans on going into politics?
I think he was in it already.
Well, they do not have a monopoly on mistruths, untruths, right? So anyway, so that's very interesting. I think that the whole spy angle, I think there are a lot of celebrities and then and now that are asked, and that was just a resource that they used. It was fun because other people hadn't found the information or been able to really see what we saw in it. But it's all been there. It's just there. The records are there, and we may even find more smoking guns in the future.
Yeah. Now, Bill, what about Sir Arthur Conan Doyle? And the show that Nathan was talking about, Houdini, of course, the two-night special, they talked about the huge argument between Houdini and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's wife. When she tried to contact his mother, she didn't notice his birthday and all that. How much fact was there with that story and the relationship?
Well, I don't know. I can't comment on the show you're talking about. I did watch it. I think a lot of that material had kind of been taken from our research, but it wasn't.
I think
but they changed a lot of things in it, so I can't really comment about how factual any of that is.
Right.
But I can comment on Doyle and his wife and their relationship with Houdini.
I'd love that.
And Doyle's a fascinating guy. Yes. Houdini is a little. Houdini never finished past eighth grade, which wasn't uncommon. But his father was educated, and he was striving. The common wisdom about Houdini was he was always striving. He loved his mother, and his whole life revolved around his mother. Well, I don't really believe that. I think he loved his mother. He took care of her very well. But, if he loved her so much and wanted to be around her all the time, then why was he traveling 9/10 of the time and only saw her a little bit of the time for the rest of her life?
Right.
So what he was really trying to do was live up to his father's expectations. And he's trying to do this with almost no formal education whatsoever. So he does a number of things in his career that try to raise his position as a learned man, how he would be perceived as somebody intelligent. And one of the things he did was he associated himself with people he respected, and like Jack London, for example. He was friends with Jack London before Jack London passed away.
Yeah.
Doyle, when there was an opportunity, he met Doyle, and he had a high regard for Doyle. Probably thought more highly of his writing than the critics of the day did. But Doyle was a smart guy, and he had a strong power, a sense of the will. And when Doyle invited Houdini and Bess over it was in New Jersey, to have a session to maybe Lady Doyle could contact Houdini's mother.
Yeah.
And the first thing that happens is they separate Bess and Harry, and Lady Doyle asks Bess a bunch of personal questions.
Oh.
So when they get back in the same room, according to Houdini later, Bess, in code, in their old one of their old vaudeville codes, tells Harry, hey, she just tried to ask a bunch of information about Mother.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a little fishy there. They have the seance. There's a number of things. Houdini doesn't blow up during the seance. He just kind of nods and takes it all in. And then afterwards, Doyle thinks that Houdini's really impressed and believes that that Lady Doyle's made contact with his mother. And then Houdini refutes that publicly, and this is friction. And then there are some words, and then the relationship completely breaks down, and there's no contact between those two until Houdini's death.
Oh.
And what Doyle's doing during that time is he believes that spiritualism, with a capital S, a formal religion, we're at the end of days, he believes, and that he's the leader of that movement, and that he needed to convert as many people to it as possible, and that I think his motive in even encouraging Houdini was to try to turn Houdini into a spokesperson for it, because
yeah.
he was the most famous man on earth. Then when it backfires on him, Houdini, of course, goes the other way and starts exposing people. And Doyle is very close to Marjorie and her husband. She was a very famous Boston a spirit medium. And her husband, Leroy Crandon, who's a Harvard-trained surgeon, is super creepy, okay? And it could be a whole book about this guy, okay? Little boys go missing, all kinds of stuff we don't need to go into. So Doyle's even questioning. He says, well, tell me about that little boy. Tell me again the story of the little boy that you said you were going to adopt, but then you sent him back and nobody ever saw him again.
Oh.
And so he's in touch with Crandon. Houdini conveniently dies in Detroit in October of on Halloween 1926, mm-hmm. right? Now, we present the possibilities, the coincidental and circumstantial evidence that perhaps other people had it out for him. I mean, there were threats and there were opportunities and there were some inconsistent things in his behavior. We have no smoking gun that there was anything other than what we think happened, what the official story was of peritonitis.
Right.
But it did benefit the spiritualist greatly. Now, Doyle's adversary's out of the way. And what's Doyle do immediately? He starts, the day Houdini dies, he starts writing letters to Bess, saying, and he ingratiates himself with her. And before long, he starts suggesting the idea of maybe a seance to contact Houdini.
Mm.
Arthur Ford, who comes in to this picture, seduces Bess. They have a seance, and she admits that they have contacted Houdini. And, of course, what's the message from Houdini at this point? Doyle was right. I was wrong. You really can connect from the other side.
Now, wait a second, Bill. You said Bess, in fact, said yes, that you have contacted
Houdini? She did.
Wow.
And then she recanted.
Okay.
And then she attempted suicide. She was so distraught.
Oh.
Now, was Bess the one whose brother, George, was her medium contact?
No, wife.
Bess was his... I'm sorry. Bess Houdini was Houdini's wife.
Oh, Bess. Okay.
Sorry
Bess
about
wife.
That.
Okay.
Yes.
Sorry.
Marjorie, whose brother Walter was the... He was the one who died in the train accident, and he was the guide on the other side.
Now, just a few weeks ago, we had Dan Aykroyd from Ghostbusters on the show, and he is a firm believer that Marjorie was legitimate and that that Houdini was never able to disprove her. What's the story behind that?
I was trying to get you on with him, Bill.
Sorry about that. That would have been fun.
Yeah, it would have.
Maybe we could do it in the future.
Maybe.
I do not believe that. I'm not ruling out the possibility of anything being real at any given time, but we've read all of Crandon and Marjorie's private papers, correspondence. We've read all of Houdini's diaries, what he's really thinking at the time this happens.
Right.
And I don't think for one second Houdini thought that he was fooled. I don't think he was gullible enough to write in his diary that he saw through her immediately when, in fact, she had really made contact. I mean, if he's seeing fraudulent and deceptive techniques used, he's not going to believe she's doing the real thing, right?
Yeah, right.
So I don't think those two had such abilities. I really do not believe it. And when you factor in what we know, it's not so much made public yet about how creepy Crandon is, it just compounds it. It just doesn't seem... Now, I would have thought Doyle was working in good faith until I saw some of the behind the scenes, and he did some terrible things. He, for example, was in contact with one of Houdini's closest confidants, his lawyer, mm-hmm. and Houdini's lawyer. And Houdini's lawyer is the witness to Bess falling apart and using drugs and attempted suicide and depression, and he's writing, and it's so it's so sensitive to him that he won't even dictate it to his secretary. He writes it by hand and sends it to Doyle because he doesn't want anybody to know about the situation Mrs. Houdini's in.
Right.
And what's Doyle do with the sensitive material? He immediately has it dictated and typed up and sent right back to Crandon.
Jesus.
In Boston. So that's how I have come to this, you know, position where I think Doyle didn't have completely clean hands in the whole scene.
Trying to exploit it.
And Doyle hated writing Sherlock Holmes. He hated he was a failed novelist. He was famous for his short stories for Sherlock Holmes, but he didn't want to do it. So he was always looking for another form of making money. It was.
Well, I don't think he did this to make money. I think he really, I think the royalties, I don't know much about that aspect, but I suspect the royalties from the Holmes stories made him plenty of money. I don't think he needed, you know, he was doing lectures and there was some, I'm sure he got reimbursed, but, and his books were pretty successful about his American journey and, you know, the books he wrote about spiritualism.
Mm-hmm.
But I think he was earnest in a way, but at the same time wasn't above using deception and trickery.
Right, because he believed it to be true, so if he put a little spin on it, whatever, you still get the understanding.
Yeah,
I feel you.
That's not an uncommon opinion, right? I personally don't accept it, but...
Right.
That is one of the excuses as well. They don't always feel it, so you have to have something for the crowd, right?
Right.
And that explains the way when they get caught
the
being
prestige,
deceptive.
The prestige in the magic world, as it'd be told. But, you know, Bill, we started talking about the actual cause of death for Harry. A lot of people, Mr. Eric Weiss, Harry Houdini, a lot of people think still from the old movie, oh, he died in the... Chinese water torture cell.
Right.
Could you clear
that
up?
We're so unfair. You know, they should have never changed that. So he died, apparently. No autopsy was done, and the medical records are yet to be discovered. I'm pretty sure they exist. I've been on the trail of them numerous times, but I've never seen them. And he most likely, if you apply Occam's razor, he had a pre-existing, I guess it's called asymptomatic condition of appendicitis. So he had appendicitis while he's in Canada at McGill, but he doesn't know it. He's not feeling it.
All right.
He, at that point, and I have no evidence he ever did this at any other occasion, he was inviting people to punch his abdomen, and on at least three people at different occasions while he was in Montreal, punched him in the abdomen, and then he had pain. And, of course, the story was, well, it punched him in the abdomen, and he wasn't ready, so it ruptured his appendix. Well, you don't get appendicitis from a punch. You just don't. It just doesn't work that way. Otherwise, football players and boxers and lots of people get appendicitis from it. And it's a bacterial condition. It doesn't happen that way.
Right.
And he probably had a condition. He got a punch. It hurt. Then a couple days later, he's in more pain, but he's attributing it to the punch, therefore ignores it. Where if he hadn't been punched and all of a sudden spontaneously he starts getting a terrible pain in his abdomen, he may very well have seen a doctor and saved his life.
Yeah, in Detroit.
So I suspect what happened, that he ignored the pain because he thought it was the punch. Of course, the appendix just gets worse and ruptures and fills his peritoneum with poison.
Right.
And he went on stage and couldn't finish in Detroit and ended up in Grace Hospital. And after a surgery or two, I don't recall which, he died on Halloween.
Also amazing, the timing on all this. But, you know, 1917... what performance almost killed him? That was one of the questions I wanted to ask you, because I have no idea. And is that where they got this whole Chinese water torture thing from?
1917? What performance? Nothing almost killed him in the sense of he had a close call with the milk can, but he wasn't doing the milk can in 1917.
Okay.
He certainly put his life at risk on numerous occasions, but most of his upside-down water torture cell, which he did all the time, certainly was dangerous, but he knew how to do it, and it didn't change every night. So I don't believe there was any... I think they just put that in the film that way so that it...
Right.
It just added
trauma.
So
they just grabbed that out of the clouds, that the cause of death was water torture.
let's back up a little bit. He was, because of his early career in the circus,
right?
He was the first magician to really bring life and death to the stage for magic.
Yeah.
Okay. There'd been, since the 16th century, magicians had been catching bullets from guns, which is dangerous, but I think a lot of times it's the way it's performed by magicians, the audience thinks it's just a trick, mm-hmm. right? It's not really dangerous. But when he did the milk can on stage, which is an oversized can full of water, padlocked,
right.
That's really, really life and death, and a number of people did die doing that. So he was the first to start doing, really risking his life on stage during essentially a magic performance.
People love a clock, right? In the magic world, people love a clock. You get the clock.
Yeah,
ticking.
Well, they. It is amazing that he could have the power over an audience while they're not even watching him. They're really just watching a curtain, right?
Right.
But he did risk his life in that, and then he wanted to be seen. He wanted them to know he was inside the device, and that's when they created the version with the glass front, which is the Chinese water torture cell.
Yeah.
And now, that he did for a long time. He only did the milk can for a few years, but he did the water torture cell for the rest of his career.
And I've always kind of, the way growing up, watching the movies, that kind of stuff, the idea I always got was that he had breathed in water or something like that. That's what they kind of make you think from the movies, because his appendicitis was kicking in and he couldn't bend and twist the way he would have to get out. And
No, he didn't do it that night. It was nothing. It was just that's just the movies.
But there is possibly, Bill, there's a question as to, was the spiritualist community behind his death? Because before you kind of stutter-stepped there and said, well, you know, I can't. What do you think about that? I mean, it's appendicitis, but no autopsy was done. Everybody wanted him dead. What do you think in the spiritualist community?
Slip a little something into his tea, maybe?
Well, we tried. We had some very top forensic scientists that were willing to do a test on his remains, but there was an issue. He doesn't have any children, doesn't have any grandchildren, never did, and there are some descendants of his brother, and one of them was going along with it, and two of them said, we don't want to bother, we don't want to do this, so the forensic scientist, Professor Stars, said, unless the whole family's behind it, I don't want to do it, so it was dropped. But what would he have tested for? He would have tested for poisons, heavy metal poisons. The problem I see that he had a lot of enemies. Certainly there were people that benefited from his death, and there certainly were people that were wishing it on him. I believe that fully. But problem with if you're doing a long-term sort of poisoning, how do you have access? We don't know enough. With everything we've got about him, we don't know enough about everybody who was around him on the train. You know, he was not an ostentatious, he wasn't like a celebrity today who had all kinds of handlers and people, and, you know, it was just his wife and a secretary and a couple of assistants, and, you know, they were going by train, and they would have had to have access. And the only one that had that kind of access was his wife, and I do not think in any way that that's a possibility that there was, you know, she was up to no good. I don't believe that for one second.
Right.
So, yes, in theory, there are certain things. He had certain manic behavioral hiccups towards the end. He was doing strange things, even for him. And that's interesting. But there's still no evidence, and there's no... I don't see any pathway to having the access to do a long-term poisoning.
Right.
And I think that even in 1926, if it had been an acute poisoning, not a long-term small dose of thing, you know, putting it in his tea every morning for, you know, 6 weeks or something, I think they would have immediately recognized and diagnosed that. I don't think that would have been taken as appendicitis. And then they did do the surgeries. There's no question that there was poison in his peritoneum. And that the appendix had ruptured.
Yeah, so that definitely was a factor in there, but it still could have been... I'm playing devil's advocate here, Bill. We got conspiracy,
right.
Baby! That's what sells it. But, you know, I wanted to ask you, Bill, I know I've kept you over, brother, because I could keep you here for 2 months talking about Houdini, but...
I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying it a lot.
Oh,
you
thanks.
Guys are great.
Oh, you're great, man. I want to join. I want to get in with the research center and learn some actual magic because, you know, I'm 41 here in September. I got another 41 years to go and I'll be a okay magician? My God. I need to sign
no,
up.
No, you can learn it faster than that.
Yeah.
You don't need 40 years to do it. But we have the resources. If somebody wants to learn magic, both the history and the practical, we do have the resources, and there, a lot of it's digital and accessible from anywhere in the world. So,
well, I got to ask you, Bill, and then I'm going to ask you to hold it on the line while Nathan asks you his final questions or whatever, and we're just going to talk to you for a second after the show while we close out. Is that okay?
Sure.
But I do
sure.
have to ask you. When did Houdini tell Bess, when I die, if I die before you, whatever, if I can come back, I'm going to give you this code? When did he say that, and what?
It's a really good question.
What was the code, do you think, in your opinion? What was that magic word that he would tell
Bess? It's a really good question, and I'll tell you this. We found we tried to find two or three sources for every story we told in the book, okay? There's certain things missing because we couldn't corroborate them. But the stories had been told by others. But when it comes to that, we found no evidence that he ever had a code with his wife. Now, we do have evidence he had codes with lots of other people. We found no evidence that he actually ever had a code with his wife. That doesn't mean he didn't have one.
Right.
And she said they did. And she revealed that code, but we didn't find, other than where she gave it to the author, Harold Kellogg, in 1927. Other than that, we found no evidence. There's nothing in the diaries to say, I have a code with Bess that we found. There's nothing in letters.
Wow.
Now, for other people, yes. For him, for her, I mean... we did not find corroboration Doesn't mean that she it makes perfect sense to have a code with her, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it would.
I mean, she's the closest person to him for many, many, many years at that point.
Well, that's why you'll never find evidence, because they never wrote anything down. It was just between the two of them.
Right.
But
he could have said it. He could have written a note that says, you know, today Bess and I made the code. Or, you know, there's possibility of evidence. Mm. It's just we haven't found any.
Bill, did you ever meet any of the magicians that set in the seances with Bess, or did one, Houdini seance in the Knickerbocker? Do they still do those?
They do them not there. They do them in different places around the world, and I have met people who did them with Bess.
Wow.
And I even was lucky enough to meet one of Houdini's very last assistants that was on the tour with them. Who was like 16 years old and the daughter of a preacher who allowed, you know, kind of let Mr. and Mrs. Houdini take the daughter to perform in the show, and she was 100 years old. She was just a delight. I mean, she only knew certain stories, and she made it clear that she palled around with Bess Houdini. She wasn't left alone with Harry. Not that he was a lech or anything, but just that, you know, that was how it was in those days. She was Bess's pal. But they'd sneak across the border to get, you know, it was prohibition, and Bess was a drinker. So, you know, they're trying to smuggle in booze on the train coming into Detroit. And, you know, it's funny stories. But so I did meet some of those people, yes. And there were people at those seances that are just in the past few years have passed on.
Amazing. That's amazing.
Well, I've got a two-part question to end here with, because I know Sean wants us to stay within our carrier's timeline here. So
not really. Not with Bill on. I want to go over it.
Okay. So it's number one. Historically speaking, this is getting away from Houdini a little bit and just getting the magic. Historically speaking, the magicians, or let's say magic, not magicians, but the use of magic in history, whether it be from the Celts down to the Magi of Persia, how much of their magical powers do you think were sleight of hand in ye olden days?
Oh, I personally believe it all was sleight of hand. And there is a way to sort of check that we've done. In the 70s, there were some pre-literate tribes, and they still are around, harder to go see now than they were 20 years ago when we went. But in Venezuela and various parts of South America, and there are probably other places in the world as well, but tribes that had kind of successfully hidden out for since eternity and never been found by modern man until the 70s,
yeah,
like the Yanomamo in Venezuela. And we went down, David Blaine and I went on when we were filming a TV show for him, and we flew down to from Puerto Ayacucho hours into the jungle and landed on a strip that missionaries had built on the Orinoco, and went down the river to a village and stayed with them. And sure enough, these are people who have never had a written language. So they're just literally like going back in time. They live just like they've lived for 5,000 years. And the head shaman, he's doing magic tricks.
Wow.
So we know that they were used in that way, pre-literate times. And then once we start having writing about 2,500 years ago or so comes in, writing comes in about 5,000 years ago, but some of the earliest writings, maybe in the 2,500 BC range, are some of them are about performances of magic, and they're things that we can sort of recognize as things that are still being done today. And there are manuscripts. I discovered a manuscript that was written in Arabic in the Islamic world in the 13th century, and the man is describing things that are still you might see a magician do today.
Well, it just so many people have the belief system based on this, and I don't dispute anyone's belief, but it's always fascinated me that the leaders of these groups you would see them, you read about them doing this magic, and when you read about it, you sit there thinking, wow, that sounds like a cup and ball trick there. It's that they're doing. It's
there were certainly ways of doing that. This, like I said before, this doesn't mean that this means that there were no miracles ever. You know, nothing in that. This does, in no way am I saying that the miracles of the Bible were all tricks.
Right.
Okay. What I'm saying is that tricks have been involved in creating a power dynamic on a quasi-religious basis since the beginning of time.
Okay, now going from my section two of this question moves from, 1300 BC to modern day. What's your opinion on Val Valentino? The masked magician.
Yeah.
Oh, good question. Yeah.
I have to say, totally meaningless. There's no way. You absolutely, actually cannot expose magic in such a way. Okay? It would be the same as saying, we're going to expose how to do surgery. And they show a guy, cutting open a human chest and doing cardiac surgery. And the audience watching this saying, oh, well, now I know how to do that.
Right. No big deal.
Of course, you can see the tools.
Yeah.
But the tools where the trapdoors are, as an analogy, that's not the method. The method is purely psychological. Okay?
Right.
We use all kinds of things to get you to not see the deceptive little apparatus if needed, or the moves, or whatever they are. All the magic happens, the kind of magic I'm talking about, are performance magic by magicians. It all happens in the brains, in the minds of the audience.
Yeah.
That's something Val Valentino doesn't even understand and can't understand. And that was just, he's just a mercenary. I mean, I don't subject myself to those kinds of shows. But the few bits of it that I've seen, they actually were making up methods that didn't exist just to show, to sell it as a TV show.
Yeah, something.
Yeah. And so I think it's meaningless. And the truth is, you can immediately go to Google or YouTube and find all kinds of stuff explaining all kinds of things, and it makes no difference. A good performer can watch all that, and he'll fool you with it 5 seconds later because you really didn't understand what the point of it was unless you really have a knowledge of the psychology.
Okay, Bill, so after the show, I need you to tell me how to perform the spirit magic cabinet, the spirit cabinet trick without a person being in the cabinet, okay? I'm going to do it at this year's Halloween.
Could be done.
I've seen it done. I forget the name of the magician. He performs at the Magic Castle all the time, and it's an amazing trick. I think Thurston did it.
Did you see Mike Caveney do it?
Yes, Mike Caveney's trick. Yeah, yeah.
Boy, I got to tell you.
Oh, wow.
Don't look to me to tell you how he does it. he fooled me and a room full of the 200 best magicians in the world and best historians in the world. I assure you, not a person in that room had any idea what he was doing other than him and the people that were on stage with him.
Yeah, well, perhaps it's just ghost. That's what I'm going to believe mine.
Could be. That's as good an explanation as I've heard, because I have no idea what that guy was doing.
Because we'll never
hear. He's really, really, not only is Mike Caveney a great guy, he is a great historian and a great performer. And those two parts don't always go together. And he's a tremendously good performer.
Well, I think to be good in the world of magic, and I'm not a magician any good, but I think to be good in this art form, you have to love the history first.
Well, it helps. You know, Houdini was the kind of guy when he was in his 20s, when he was touring in a town, he'd go off in the daytime when he didn't have to perform, and he'd go find old-timers and listen to them tell stories. And he really loved it. Ricky Jay is the kind of guy who studies magic on a such a high level, and he uses the historical that he studied to inform his act, to create bits for his performance pieces. And David Blaine is using historical. You're going to see some things I can't talk about that he's going to do that come straight out of the history books. In fact, things that people didn't believe could really be done.
Yeah,
David Copperfield, Penn and Teller, All your high-level people do this.
It's amazing. All your
and they
guys.
Know they're doing it. David Copperfield has the greatest collection of magic, historical magic material ever assembled in the world. If Houdini came back from the dead, he would have to go to Copperfield to get his whole show back. I mean, it's incredible what he's got there.
Well, we've
and
been
he's doing that because of the respect of history.
Yes.
We've been trying to get Penn and Teller on the show for years, but they've only said that we could have Teller.
Yeah.
So
and he won't talk. Right, and he won't say a word.
That'd be a short interview. But, Bill, I'm going to ask you to stay on the line 1 second. I tell you, where can our listeners find out more about you? Because you're amazing.
Well, there's not much about me, but, you know, if they're interested in magic, conjuringarts.org is our nonprofit, and we're trying every day to make the website a friendly place for people interested in magic to come and find out more about magic without it being too inside baseball, right? So hopefully that's a good gateway to get to get interested in magic. So conjuringarts.org, which is it's our public charity. It's 501c3 in New York City that we collect and make materials available for people to do research.
Right. And folks, that's Conjuring Arts. That's conjuringarts.org.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah, check that out, guys. And of course, you can check out this archive because the show will be up tonight with William, and we'll have that up within the next hour if you're just tuning in, which I don't know why you would be. But if you missed it, we always give you a do-over. So anyway, I tell you what, William, you are amazing, sir. Thank you so much for coming on.
Sean, Nathan, thank you very much. I really appreciate the invitation. If you want to do it again in the future, let me know. And if I'm available, I'd be happy to do that.
Okay. Oh, you know we will call you on that.
Absolutely. So that's good. I wouldn't offer if I didn't mean it. Trust me.
Thanks, brother. So, could you hold on the line 1 second while we pay the bills?
Sure.
Nathan, what do you say we pay these bills?
Okay.
All right, guys. William Kalush, New York Times bestselling author, The Secret Life of Houdini. Special thanks to all our homes, all our sponsors, Stitcher Smart Radio, Spreaker, the world's listening. Are you? Check them out, Spreaker.com, Planet Paranormal, Geeky Antics Network, Serious Geeks, Silly Fun, GeekyAntics.net, Attentive Home Healthcare, AttentiveHHC.com, and the SYL Project. Give some love, share some love. Everybody needs love. Check them out, the SYL Project.com. From the haunted back roads of America, this has been another exclusive G&D Show interview. Don't go changing America. You know we won't. Demon Hunter.
Because we love you.
Night, guys.